In this fourth lecture of database management system, today we will try to understand what keys and functional dependencies are. The agenda for today is we learn the keys and different types of keys, about functional dependencies, some trivial and non-trivial dependencies, and then the closure of a set of dependencies. At the end, we'll do an exercise and summarize the lecture. Now, keys. When we say key, we mean to say that it is a set of attributes or maybe an attribute which can uniquely identify an entity in the relation. So, if there is a table R, it may contain number of attributes A1, A2, maybe till AN. Out of these attributes, the set of attributes that uniquely identify a tuple from that relation, those are called keys. Now, there are different types of keys: super key, candidate key, primary key, alternate key, and foreign key. To define a super key, let K be a subset of R, which means that K is a set of attributes of a relation R. So this set of attributes we denoted by K is called a super key of R if the values for K are sufficient to identify a unique tuple of each possible relation R of R. This again means that K is a set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple in a relation. We may also say that a super key has uniqueness property. Uniqueness means no two tuples will hold the same value for that attribute. For example, out of number of students in a class, each student having attributes like roll number, its name, its age, its date of birth, its address, the attribute, say, roll number will be unique for all the students. And also, a set of roll number and name will also be unique for each and every student. So, super key has a uniqueness property, and thus no two tuples will have the same value for super key. If K is a super key for the relation R and A is an attribute of R, then K implies A, which means that if for a relation student having attributes roll number, name, and age, roll number can imply student name, which means that if I know the roll number, I can determine the name. Or each roll number will have only one name. So, it does not have irreducibility property. Super key has uniqueness property, but it does not have irreducibility property, which means that this super key is again reducible into a subset, which is again a super key. It can contain a subset that has the uniqueness property. By saying this, we mean to say that the subset of any super key can also be a super key in itself. Out of many possible subsets of a super key, there may be few subsets which are again having uniqueness property, and since they are, and then they are super keys. So, super key has uniqueness property but does not have irreducibility property. Coming to candidate keys, how is it different from a super key? Let K be a set of attributes of relation variable R. Then K is a candidate key of R if and only if it has both uniqueness and irreducibility property. So candidate key, since it has got uniqueness property, it is a super key by all means. But in addition to it, it also has got irreducible property. Again, when we say uniqueness, we mean to say that no legal value of R ever contains two distinct tuples with the same value for R. For example, roll number is a candidate key. So, no two students can have the same roll numbers. Talking about irreducibility, this means that no proper subset of K has the uniqueness property. In this respect, a candidate key can be defined as a minimal super key. So, candidate key should have two properties, uniqueness and irreducibility. No two tuples should have the same value for the candidate key. And also, no proper subset of a candidate key will be a super key. Let us take an example. Customer name and customer street. The set of these two attributes combine to form a super key. A combination of the customer name and the customer street. Customer number and customer street. We assume that customer number is unique for each customer. So, customer number combined with customer street can give a unique identification to each customer. Apart from that, customer number alone is also capable enough to identify every customer uniquely. So, both these attributes or set of attributes are super keys. But let us see the difference. Customer number and customer street. This is a super key. It has got the uniqueness property. But it is not irreducible. This is because we can see that customer number is a subset of this super key, which again is a super key. So this is reducible. Now since we can reduce this super key into customer number, this is a super key, but it is not a candidate key. Here, if we see customer number, this is a super key and also it has no subset, which is again a super key. So, candidate key is the minimal super key, which means that it is a super key and no subset of it is a super key. So, here customer name is a candidate key. Then there are primary keys, alternate keys, and foreign key. keys. Now we know what are the candidate keys. Now it is a set of attributes which is the minimal super key. It is possible that a relation may contain a number of candidate keys, which means that there are so many set of attributes which can uniquely identify tuples in a relation. In that case, one must choose one of the candidate keys as the primary key, and the remaining candidate keys are the alternate keys. So, in case when the relation has a number of candidate keys, one of them is chosen as the primary key and the others are the alternate keys. Talking about foreign key, a foreign key is a set of attributes of some relation variable R2 whose values are required to match the values of some candidate key of some relation variable R1. So, if an attribute is a foreign key, it means that the value of those attributes can either be null or it should be same as the values of some other attribute which is a candidate key in its own relation. Now, here R2 and R1 can also be the same. So, the foreign key can also refer to some candidate key of its own relation also. Coming to functional dependencies, if we define functional dependency, it is a many-to-one relationship from one set of attributes to another within a given relation variable. Let us see, if R be a relation and X and Y be the subsets of the attributes of R. So, R is the name of the relation, X is any set of attributes of that relation, and Y is another set of attributes of the same relation. Now, X implies Y. It says that this is the functional dependency existing between X and Y. So, we say that Y is functionally dependent on X, or X determines Y, which means that the value of X will determine the value of Y, or the value of Y is dependent on the value of X. So, which means that Y is functionally dependent on X, or X is functionally determining Y. So, X is called the determinant and Y is called the dependent. So, this is the functional dependency existing between X and Y, where X is one set of attributes, Y will be another set of attributes of a relation R. Let us redefine by saying that a set of attributes X functionally determines a set of attribute Y if the value of X determines a unique value of Y. If I say row number 1, only one student should come up, which means that roll number is the determinant. So x implies y holds if whenever there are two tuples having the same value for x, they must have the same value for y. Let us denote it this way. If there are two tuples t1 and t2 in a table, if the value of x in the tuple t1 is same as the value of x in t2, then the value of y in t1 should also be equal to the value of y in t2. This means that x determines y. So whenever there are more than one tuples in which the value of x is same, the value of y will also be the same. So if t1x is equal to t2x, then t1y is also equal to t2y in any relation instance R. So this is x determines y, or y is dependent on x. Let us take some examples of functional dependency constraints. Taking first example, as the social security number of any employee. So every person, every employee has got a unique social security number. No two employees can have the same social security number. So we can say that social security number determines the value of employee's name. So if the social security number is 101, it will always belong to a single person. Now this is unique here. Second example. Let's take example of projects where each project is identified by a project number. There is a project name and project location. In this case, project number determines project name and project location. So, if we know the project number, we can have project name and location. So, whenever, it also means that whenever the project number is same in two or more tuples, whenever the project number is same, the name and location of the project will also be same. Let us take another example. Employee has a social security number and that employee works on number of projects. So employee's social security number and the project number determines the hours per week that the employee works on the project. Now, there are number of employees and there are number of projects running in an organization. Every employee works on many projects, but for each project that employee spends different number of time, different number of hours. So the social security number which identifies the employee and project number which identifies the project will combinedly form will combinedly determine the number of hours worked on a project. So, the employee with this social security number working on works on this project number for this much number of hours. So here, the social security number and the project number will determine number of hours worked on the project. Or we can say that the number of hours depend upon the social security number and the project number. Let us take another example to understand what these functional dependencies are. Let's a relation R. Let us take example of relation student. Student has attributes: student ID, last name, the major that he has chosen, the credits allotted for the subject, and a social security number. Now, these are the functional dependencies that exist in this relation student. Student ID. Student ID determines the last name, or last name is dependent upon student ID. If I say student ID 101, so there will be only one last name for the student having ID 101, because the same student cannot have more than one last names. So, last name will be dependent on student ID. But we have to note that the reverse is not true. Reverse may not be true. Last name is not determining student ID, which means that student ID is not dependent on last name. If suppose the last name is Singh, so there may be so many students in the class with the last name Singh. If I call Singh, there may be 3 students with IDs 1, 2 and 3, they may stand up. So, last name will not determine student ID. So, student ID determines last name, but last name does not determine student ID. So, this is one of the functional dependencies that exist in R, in the student table. Another functional dependency, student ID also determines the set of attributes: last name, major, credits, social security number and student ID. So if we know the student ID, or if the student IDs are same, the last name will be the same, major will be the same, credits, social security number and student ID, the set of all these attributes will also be the same. Another functional dependency that exists is the social security number determines student ID, last name, major, credits and social security number. Now here we know that social security number is unique for every person. So here again, social security number will determine all these attributes, or the set of all these attributes is dependent upon the social security number. Whenever the social security number is same, the set of all these tuples will also be the same. There are certain trivial dependencies. Picol and FD trivial. If and only if the right side is a subset of the left side. In this case, suppose there is a relation supplier and parts. So the supplier number and part number combination will always determine supplier number. So this is a trivial dependency, or supplier number and part number will determine supplier number, and supplier number and part number will also determine part number. So here, if, now see, supplier number and part number combination has got two subsets. One, supplier number, another, part number. So, if the right hand side is a subset of left hand side, such functional dependencies are called trivial dependencies. All the other dependencies are called non-trivial dependencies. Talking about closure of a set of dependencies. A relation has got a number of attributes, and there are number of functional dependencies that exist in the relation R. Out of these dependencies, we can also derive some more dependencies. So, the set of all functional dependencies that are implied by a given set S of FD is called the closure of S. So, out of the dependencies that exist, that are known, we can also imply, or we can also derive some other functional dependencies. A set of these functional dependencies which we have derived from the other functional dependencies are called the closure of functional dependencies. Now, how to derive or imply these another functional dependencies? For this, we have Armstrong's axioms. These are used to infer or derive functional dependencies from other functional dependencies. Now, let us consider a relation variable R having the attributes A, B and C. So, capital R is the relation and it has three attributes A, B and C. And when we say A, B, we mean to say it is a union of A and B. Now, let us learn what the Armstrong's axioms are. These Armstrong's axioms help us to derive new functional dependencies out of existing functional dependencies. Reflexivity is the first axiom, is the first rule. Reflexivity. What do we mean by reflexivity? If B is a subset of A, then B is dependent on A. Now remember, A is a set of attributes, B is also a set of attributes. So, if B is a subset of A, it will always depend on A. Which means that whenever the value of A is same, the value of B will also be the same. Rule number two, which we call augmentation rule, says that if A determines B, then AC determines BC. Here, A is a set of attributes, B is another set of attributes, and C is another set of attributes in a relation R. So, if A determines B, AC also determines BC. This is augmentation. Third rule is transitivity. We know transitivity. If A is equal to B and B is equal to C, then A is equal to C. In the same way, if A determines B and B determines C, then A also determines C. This is transitivity. If A determines B and B determines C, A also determines C. And then we have a self-determination. A always determines itself. Every attribute or a set of attributes always determines itself. So A determines A, B determines B, C determines C. This is a self-determination. So reflexivity says that if B is a subset of A, B is always dependent on A. Augmentation says that if A determines B, AC determines BC. Transitivity says if A determines B and B determines C, A determines C. And self-determination says that A always determines itself. Another rule is decomposition rule. If A determines BC, it means that A determines B and A also determines C. So here we can see if A determines BC, A determines B and then A determines C also. This is decomposition. You can see we are decomposing it into B and C. Then the union rule. If A determines B and A also determines C, it means that A is determining both B and C. So, if A determines B and A determines C, then A determines B, C. This is union. Last one is composition. Now see, if A determines B and C determines D, then AC determines BD. This is a composition rule. When A determines B and C determines D, we take both left sides together and both right hand side together. So AC determines BD. So decomposition says that if A determines BC, A determines B and also A determines C. Union says that if A determines B and A determines C also, A determines both B and C. Composition says if A determines B and C determines D, AC determines BD. Means the combination of the determinants will determine the combination of dependence. Let us take an example of closure of F. As we know, the closure of F is a set of functional dependencies which have been derived by the other functional dependencies. So there are certain functional dependencies in R from which, using Armstrong's axioms, we will derive some more functional dependencies, and set of these dependencies is called the closure. So if capital F denotes the set of all functional dependencies which are known, then the closure of F is denoted by F. Now, let us take an example. Let R be a relation with attributes A, B, C, G, H and I. And capital F is the set of functional dependencies. These dependencies are A determines B, another is A determines C, C, G determines H, C, G determines I, and B determines H. So these are the five functional dependencies which exist in capital F. Out of this, let us apply some of the Armstrong's axioms and derive some other functional dependencies. Some of the members of F closure are, one of this is A determines H. How did it happen? This is because of the transitivity rule. Now, we know that if A determines B and B determines C, A determines C. Now look at the functional dependencies in capital F. We know that A determines B. There is a functional dependency. A determines B. There is also a functional dependency in F. B determines H. So, by transitivity rule, if A determines B and B determines H, A will also determine H. So, by applying transitivity rule to these existing functional dependencies, we have implied that A determines H. So, we have got one of the members of F closure. Another dependency. Let us apply augmentation rule now. A determines C and use it with G. Apply G. So here we get AG determines CG. So if we apply augmentation on AC with G, we get AG determines CG. Here, A determines C. So, AG determines CG by augmentation. Upon this, we apply transitivity that CG determines I. We also know that CG determines I. So, applying augmentation on A determines C, we got AG determines CG. Applying transitivity here, we came to know that when AG determines CG and CG determines I, then AG determines I. So this is what we got. AG determines I. We applied augmentation on A determines C with G. We got AG determines CG, and we knew that CG determines I. So, if AG determines CG and CG determines I, AG determines I. This is another functional dependencies which we implied from the existing set of dependencies. Let us take derive one more dependence. We augment CG determines I to infer that CG determines CGI. Why it is so? We know that it is self-determining I. So CG determines I means CG determines CGI. And we also augment CG of determines H to get CGI determines HI. Now, CG determines CGI and CGI determines HI. Using transitivity, we get that CG determines HI. So, by augmentation, we got that CG determines CGI and again CGI determines HI. So, CG determines HI. This is another functional dependency that we derived. Summarizing, we learned today about super keys. It's a set of attributes which will uniquely identify a tuple in a relation. It has got uniqueness property, but it does not have irreducibility property. Candidate key. Candidate key is a minimal super key. So a candidate key is also a super key, but a super key is not a candidate key because a candidate key has uniqueness property and irreducibility property. But super key has uniqueness but not irreducible. So a candidate key is a super key, but a super key cannot be a candidate key always. So candidate key is the minimal super key consisting of uniqueness property and irreducibility property. There may be so many candidate keys existing in a relation. Out of these candidate keys, one may be chosen as primary key and the remaining candidate keys are called alternate keys. Then we have foreign keys, which is a set of attributes in a relation R1 which will hold either null or will hold the values, only those values which are present in the candidate key of some other relation R2 or maybe R1. We also learned about functional dependencies where X implies Y means X determines Y, or value of Y is dependent on X. We also learned about certain trivial dependencies. If the right hand side of the functional dependency is a subset of the left hand side, we call it a trivial dependency. All the rest are non-trivial dependencies. We also learned certain axioms, Armstrong's axioms. Applying those axioms, we can derive some new functional dependency from the set of dependencies which we denote by capital F and closure is F. Now, I am sure we will be able to do this exercise with the help of today's lecture. The question is, find the closure of F using these functional dependencies. So this is the relation student showing the number of student, which is the student number, student name. So student number is the identification for student, student name, the address of the student, course number that the student is learning, course name, so this is the name of this course, and the instructor who teaches that course to the student, and the office of the instructor. This is the office of the instructor. So in this relation gives the information about the student, the course that student studies, and the instructor who teaches that course to this student. Now, looking at this tuples, you will understand that there are three different courses which are being taken by the same student. So Smith, whose number is 85001, takes a course CP302, 303, 304, and these are the instructors who teach in the course. Now here, the functional dependencies that exist are: student number determines student name. It is very clear by this table that student number determines student name. It means that whenever the student number is same, the name of the student will be same. Let us check. Whenever the student number is same, look at these three tuples. Whenever the number are same, we'll have Smith for the same number. So the name of the student is dependent on the student number. In the same way, name of the course is dependent on course number. Let us see. Take an example of first and fourth tuple. So wherever we have CP302, the name of the course is database. It is the same. So course number determines name of the course. We also have student number determines address, which means that whenever the student number is same, the address is also the same. Another functional dependency is course number determines instructor. Let us see course number. So whenever course number is same, name of the instructor is same. Instructor determines office. So wherever the instructor name is same, office number is also the same. So now you can apply Armstrong's axioms on this functional dependencies and retrieve some other functional dependency, that is the closure of F. You may refer these books to learn these topics in detail.